Welcome to part two of our interview with Aziz Ibrahim. If you haven't heard part one yet, you can at the StageLeftPodcast.com on iTunes, Spotify, or Audio Boom. Part one covers Aziz's upbringing, entering the music industry, and talks in detail about his time in the Stone Roses, and even plays a few segments of Iron the Resurrection, Fool's Gold, Waterfall. It's awesome. Here's part two, and he will be talking about his time as Ian Brown's songwriter, how he composed some classics such as My Star, and details what it's like working with Paul Weller as well. So just a reminder to keep in the loop, follow us at the Stage Left Pod on Twitter or facebook.com/thestageleftpodcast. Come and say hi, and here's part two of Aziz Ibrahim. Is it right, a song that appeared on Ian's first album, Ice Cold Cube, was that composed with the Stone Roses? Didn't you play that song beforehand with the Stone Roses? I think you played that at Reading.
Yeah.
A version of it.
We did, but... we played, Ice Cold Cube, the original version, during the Third Coming era, shall we say. but when I was working on Ian's first debut album, Unfinished Monkey Business, I revamped the whole song. So what I did was I changed the rhythm of it to... That's it. It was those kind of riffs I put in. I made it into this kind of Beatlesque style, almost Wurlitzer chop kind of thing. And I started to change all the arrangement and add extra chords. All those melodies, I put in. So it was quite far away from the original, but there was material on there that was from the Roses era, Twilight.
That kind of period between the end of the Roses and the beginning of Ian's solo career. Ian said he expected to spend his life selling Roses bootlegs for a living, because he said, I'm not strong enough to be solo. So at what stage did kind of Ian identify you and ask you to be involved in his solo work? Was it a natural progression
It was a natural progression. You know what happened? I was confused as to what was going on with the Roses in 97. I didn't know what was happening. So I just dropped by Ian's one day when he was gardening and cultivating a beard. And I was asking him, what was going on, and he told me, and then told me that he had plans to, horticultural plans, and I was just kind of, okay, fair enough. And we were sat there, and I bought this acoustic guitar with me, which by mistake, but it was fate that I brought my acoustic guitar, or it might have been his, because he had an old Gibbo as well. And I sat there strumming away, and I played this. And then I played. I played this thing, and he was like, I really like that. Play that again. And then he just got his, he tore off a bit of his fag packet and started writing lyrics inside the fag packet. And all of a sudden, Corpses in Their Mouths was born. And I mean, the actual development of it came later as well, because I actually recorded Corpses in Their Mouths at home. I went home and recorded all the music on a cassette tape. On a four-track Porter Studio cassette tape.
Really? Sounds really layered. That sounds like...
Yeah, layered it, because I ran that... you can see my old, ancient 90s Akai sampler.
Right.
Which is that cream-coloured outfit, S2000.
Right.
So what I did was I digitally recorded loops of playing, bass guitar, with that John's old bass. And I played the bass line, play these lines, and I'd loop the parts, and then they would come in, and I'd sequence it of an old Roland MC500 sequencer running the sampler, and they were running in real time as I was playing along, and I would bounce the music onto a four-track cassette tape.
Right, okay, gotcha.
I'd take it to Ian and drop it onto his 8-track reel, And he'd have four tracks of vocals to play with. So we were going from cassette tape to a reel, a quarter inch reel. And then finally, when later on, when he decided really that he wanted to make an album, we'd bought this place called Chiswick Reach in London, and it was all valve, it was all tape, everything was, you know, organic, and we dropped the music onto a 2-inch 24 track where we added extra things, and Corpses and the Mouths came together there, because what happened was Ian wrote, you know, she's got corpses in the mouths, you know, in her mouth, and she's saying whatever. It was like he just kind of, I was just stunned by this chorus that he'd written, and I locked myself up in this cupboard, literally a little cupboard. I took my little Porter studio in there and just kept playing that chorus again and again. And then as I heard the lyrics, I was looking for something that weaved in between his lyrics, and I was playing around, and then all of a sudden I came up with... I wrote that, and that weaved, and then I had these tracks, the four tracks, so I started to bounce and drop an acoustic guitar down, and then I dropped a 12 string Rickenbacker part down, and then I put the 59 Les Paul on top of it, and the thing, that melody just came together, and then with his vocal melody, the two just weaved together, and Corpses in the Mouths was completed. And obviously with his harmonica, that was the icing on the cake. But it was a beautiful time, you know, writing time, and just him and myself. And all the press wrote, oh, Ian Brown wrote this album and blah, 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 which he did. He wrote all the lyrics, and the idea and the concepts was his, but there wasn't anybody around. We had tracks from previous Roses tunes, which we revamped. But there was only himself and myself in the studio, and the engineer, and the late Nigel Luby, who engineered at Chiswick Reach. Then we went to the Forge Studios in Oswestry, to my friend's studio, Phil Beaumont, did some more recording there, mastering, made my style more beefier and things. But it began in the bed, literally in Longsight, on this four-track cassette tape, and I've still got the master, so I don't know what the record company thinks they've got, but I've still got that master.
Awesome. And you mentioned My Star there. So that was the first single post-Roses that you wrote with him. Can you talk us through the memories of composing that tune? Because
oh, it was a beautiful time, My Star. I mean, my biggest memory of My Star is driving to Ian's house in Lim at the time, and listening to the radio, and all of a sudden My Star came on Radio 1, and I heard, you know... I was so happy, I was so proud. It was the first song I'd ever written that's been played on a radio station, and I was just beaming, and I just parked outside his house, and I wound the window down and cranked the radio up and blasted it out of the car and seeing if he could hear from, you know, up in his flat, in his house. And
it's a big tune, that, and it's interesting because I remember when that came out, a lot of people, music fans, were waiting for that to come out. We kind of presumed that, like, you guys are like, right, there's going to be pressure on this, everyone's going to be wondering what Ian Brown's going to come up with. Sure. But it was the complete opposite by the sound of things. It sounds quite relaxed.
It was so laid back.
Yeah, man.
Well, there was no engineer, there was no producer, there was no big record label. It was recorded on Ian's own budget. There was no pressure. This was the old days of when you write songs with your band. You're not signed, you're just writing music for the fun and the love of it. And that's how we wrote Unfinished Monkey Business. Just for the love of music and no agenda. I mean, obviously there's references of, you know, Dear Prudence in there, but I didn't know Dear Prudence. It wasn't a Beatles album I had, you know.
Really?
I had Rubber Soul and things like that, you know. You know, I've even forgotten the chords for that too.
In my life, yeah.
There you go. So
you didn't know Dear Prudence, because you now, when you play it live, you do sing a bit of Dear Prudence in
it
sometimes.
No, well, what it is with Dear Prudence, yes, we do, and that was Ian's idea, a little homage too. But what it is with Dear Prudence is that it's actually a natural progression on the guitar.
Yeah.
You know, to go... when you're looking for the next note, you're going to go,
yeah,
you know. And that's how it came about, and that's why it's similar to the Beatles, because maybe they learned that from
Donovan.
So,
it was Donovan.
I mean, I'm playing for Donovan at the moment.
I was going to say, you're going to be playing. Yeah.
I can see where a lot of influences come from. But for me, it was just, I didn't know Dear Prudence, and I wrote a progression which was natural for me. It actually didn't come from that. It came from the bass line.
Right.
I played bass guitar as my first instrument, and I was playing... kind of thing. I wrote this cool bass guitar riff. I put a drum loop. I got my brother to play Indian tabla. It's actually nal, but it's like tabla. A loop of that I put into my Akai sampler. So I looped the tablas, I looped the drums. I did a little bit of drum machine programming. Dropped live bass guitar onto the recording, and then recorded live guitar as well onto another track, and then layered the... Well, actually looped the 12-string Rickenbackers. And that was the basis of the whole tune then. That rhythm, tight rhythm, and the electric guitar, the 12-string guitars, loops. And then I've dropped some rock guitar on top, you know, distorted, just add it. You know, that kind of thing. And then the Indian stuff came out just purely in the tap bits and the melodies where I go... just in areas like that. And then I used Ebo for the solos, you know. And then... you know, it's a great key to play in.
Yeah.
In the actual fact, people, there has never been one correct... transcription of My Star, and the reason is my guitars were detuned.
Oh, right.
To D. Everything was detuned to D, which was a mistake vocally, because it made Ian have to sing a whole tone down, which made him sing in really low registers when really his voice shines in higher registers. If you listen to the first Roses album, you know,
yeah.
It's kind of... But for the guitar, it was a real earthy sound. My guitars are tuned in D, even though the riff's in A, it's actually in B.
Right.
So to speak. Oh, sorry, G. It's the other way around.
Yeah.
Because G would be a whole tone note.
Yeah.
So a natural G, that's the key it's in. Which actually played on the guitar in the position of A. So you get that nice open.
Yeah.
And the same with Corpses in the Mouths. The guitar's detuned.
Because you play that, when you play it live, you've got a cap on the third or fourth.
Well, I mean, normally you'd have the cap over here.
Oh, it's as high as that, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
You'd have it high as the seventh fret, so you get that.
Right.
I mean, that's without the cap, obviously.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm just trying to create the cap.
I thought I saw a version of you playing it recently, and you only had a cap. I was playing along to it.
Because I now have the guitars in concert pitch E.
Gotcha. Right.
So.
Cool, man.
Yeah, so the all the guitars were like that on those albums. So if you want to learn any of those parts, you've got to detune your guitars to D, a whole tone down, and then there were capos for Corpses, no capo for My Star, Ice Cold Cube was open again.
Mm.
Yeah.
So how did your relationship develop working with Ian? Because you worked with Ian for many, many years, but you didn't always play live with him. What other stuff were you doing at the time? Because I know you did your own albums.
Yeah, I mean, it began well. Obviously, Ian went to prison before Golden Greats. I mean, that was a horrible time, especially for him. Coming out, he changed, really. He'd been writing indoors, but I think, obviously, incarceration, you know, there's probably that feeling of kind of resentment towards... going down for something you haven't really done, you know, to be incarcerated for talking back.
Yeah.
That's what I saw. I was sat next to him on the plane.
Really?
And it was all about that, the disagreement between British Airways and him. And it was all about him being too clever for them. And the witty comments, really, you know, go and sit down, Captain Pugwash, and things like that, you know. And they absolutely railroaded him, you know.
Why? Why do you think they...
Because they wanted to make an example out of him.
Yeah.
They wanted to win. He was famous, so therefore you could use him as an example, and British Airways saves the general public from, you know, all that kind of thing. And it's just, it was so unfair.
Yeah.
And we didn't help ourselves legally. We didn't, you know, I don't, management wise, let him down, advice wise, everything went wrong. The number of witnesses is, you know, it's just, God, if we watch enough, you know, legal dramas and films, you know full well that it doesn't take more than a couple of people to corroborate a story.
And he went down for 2 months, was that right? 60 days, something like that?
No, it was a 6 month sentence.
Oh, was it? Right, okay, right, it was long, right, wow.
Yeah. He was released on maybe, I think he was released on 3, yeah.
Right, okay.
Or he was, I can't remember now, it was that long ago, but it was a real sad time, and we didn't get on at that time afterwards. So even though I was involved in Golden Greats, it was a difficult time, but I was kind of absorbed by wanting to do my own album, so I began with my first album, Lahore to Longsight, and this idea of I want to be a songwriter.
Yeah.
With encouragement from Ian and encouragement from Mike Joyce and Andy Rourke as well, and you know, great, and Paul Weller, you know.
So the people you got on this, let's get this right, the people you got on your first solo record, you got Mike Joyce, Andy Rourke, Paul Weller. Did Steve White play on this as well?
Steve White.
Yeah, Rennie did.
Rennie.
And Manny.
Yeah.
Man,
and
that is
Denise Johnson.
Denise Johnson.
Primal Scream.
So that is a stellar lineup.
For an album that's not really been released.
How did you get involved with so Weller? Where did he get involved?
I ran into him in Portsmouth.
Right, okay.
So as the Ian Brown band, we were in there, you know, nabbing clothes, getting a few freebies in. And in walks Paul with Steve White.
Right.
And we got talking. But the first thing he said to me was, "You wrote My Star, didn't you?" And I said, "Well, I didn't write the lyrics." And he said, "No, but I mean, you wrote My Star." And he says, "Oh," because he's obviously about the music and the Beatles influence, because he loves the Beatles.
Yeah.
And I know what he was getting at. And I said, "Yeah." I said, "Well," I told him the story of how it came about and things. And he just took a great interest. He invited me round, and he was recording Heliocentric at the time. And I dropped some, you know, I took my guitar, as I did. I always travel with my guitar. And I dropped some guitars on Heliocentric, the B-side and the single. And then I played a bit of sarod on it, which is that Indian instrument you can see there.
Wow, it's beautiful.
I dropped some of that onto the track. And he was, vinyl albums of sarod players. He really shocked me, you know, his depth of knowledge. And he was listening to my later band, which is myself and Dalbir Singh Rathdan, who plays tabla.
Yeah.
And he was he's into the, maybe again it's a Beatles influence of, you know, being involved with Indian music and so Indian classical music and so forth. But he knew about the sarod. He listened to my band and he said, "It sounds like John Coltrane." I said, "You listen to Coltrane?" And he's like, "Yeah." He pointed out you know, one of the last albums Coltrane did before he died.
Right.
And I was just really shocked at the depth of his knowledge, but also by the friendship, you know. I just didn't expect that friendship, but he's such a down-to-earth guy, such a lovely guy. You know, I couldn't say one bad thing about him, or hear one bad thing about him. He just took me in, really, and I was hanging out, playing music, met with Steve White and
great drummer,
and Damon Mintel at the time.
As players. Is it the
so
players?
Therefore,
yeah.
The players came about
yeah.
through that. And they
I saw
introduced
you at
me
jazz,
to...
Jazz Cafe, I think.
Right,
yeah.
Okay. Yeah, great times.
Yeah.
I mean, that was a funny gig because I was still in that, you know, go-for-it mode. So I had something like 2 Marshall 4x12s, one stacked on top of the grand piano in the jazz cafe, and one by its side or 2 by its side. And it was like, come on, Aziz. Most guys that come and play, they bring a little, you know, mini brute or, you know, polytone amps or little blues junior. And
yeah.
You got 3, 4, 4x12s,
yeah.
2 Marshall heads, 100-watt heads. And But it was the beginning of the players really meeting Paul's band. He wasn't too into it, I don't think.
Really?
It was too muso for him.
Yeah.
But, you know, I was meeting you guys. I had this respect for Mick Talbert and Damon and Steve and wanted to play in this band. And we recorded the first album, Clear the Decks, which was a great time. Again, you know, really was our love for, you know, the likes of Steve Cropper and, you know, Muscle Swords and all that kind of stuff. And the idea was to not have a vocalist and just play instrumentally, and that's why we kind of parted company, shall we say. You know, they had an idea of bringing the vocals in, and I didn't. I thought it was a great idea to stick with that original concept. But I think because so many people were sticking their two penny thin and saying, you should get a vocalist, you know, and all this kind of thing.
Didn't you bring on a female vocalist at some point, though?
I didn't bring her on, no.
Okay.
But
I'm sure there was.
She came in after the second album, or on that second album, but I'd left by then. I did some stuff for the second album, which I can't even tell you what it's called. But for me, Clear the Decks was the definitive players.
Just the band.
Direction of taking that approach of you don't always need a vocalist. Mm. You can let them give the space to the... My Mick Talbert, when you hear him play melodies and the sounds he uses, wow, you know, you just need to give him the space, and taking the vocals out was the best thing you could have done.
Yeah. Yeah, it gave so much breathing space, and it made it quite unique as well. It was, you know.
So we did some shows, we did a bit of touring. It's a shame, really, because it could have really progressed into that old school way of some great rhythm sections that create great music and come up with great instrumentals, you know, whether it's like Get Carter or something. You could come up with music which doesn't need vocals.
That's your next band, that's your next project. So you also appear on so this is a bit later when we were talking about Weller, you also appear on God, which is a song where you provide the
very
voice
strange,
of God.
Very strange.
It's great though, I mean, it's really effective. So basically the song is Aziz questioning the legitimacy of the prayers being asked of him in the role of God, if you like.
Yeah.
Did you write those poem or lyrics?
No, Paul wrote the lyrics. I mean, the strangest thing is, I mean, I was at his studio, Black Barn. It's to turn up with my guitar. I mean, obviously, I brought my guitar with me because I had every intention of playing on that album. And what actually happened was that I didn't play. I sang, or it was spoken word.
Yeah.
Only purely because he was working on that particular track, and Steve Craddock,
yeah,
was the voice of God at the time. But what happened was, God wasn't a Brummy.
I was going to say.
So
you said it. I didn't want to say it.
Not in Paul's eyes. Is anyway. And he said to me, he kind of looked at me and went, why don't you have a go? Because, you know, me with my man Caxon and everything, he says, why don't you have a go, mate? Go in there, blah, blah, blah. You know, I can't do something.
Yeah.
So I went in there and just, he wrote some lyrics first.
Yeah.
Sorry. And then finished them. And then he went in there and I went in the recording room. He said, have a go. One take, and that was it. Just had a run through. So then he must have compared the Brummy and the Mank, and I went, God's a Mank.
God's a Mank. I like it. I thought it was good, but you're not.
Oh, it was different.
It was very different.
No,
yeah.
I'm just saying that I went with the intention of playing guitar.
And you didn't get a chance to play guitar. So that's not you playing in the background. No,
I had no guitar. I just played. I just did a vocal. For me, it was an achievement because it's the first time I did a vocal on a guy who can really sing.
Yeah,
you know, his
yeah.
album. And on there you go, 22 Dreams, I'm doing the vocals for God. Featured that.
And I looked up and I spoke to God, and God said, look at you, don't look at me. You only call on me when you need me, and when you don't, you hardly think of me at all. I don't enter your head for weeks at a time, and the times I do are in your despair. That you created and not I, and still you look up at me in such pleading terms. That's how can I deny you? But don't look at me, look at you. Don't look at me, look at you.
But the album after Sonic Kicks, I did play guitar and I wrote two co-wrote two songs with Paul.
Did you? How did that work? Was that, did you work separately, or were you kind of sat in a room together?
I went with a guitar, a specific guitar that I had made for me, made by Patrick James Eggle, a great luthier, and it's a baritone acoustic. So, and I went there to impress him with this instrument, and I had a couple of chords in mind. So I played him these. I can't play you on this guitar because this is in concert pitch, and the chords are in an open tuning.
Right. Okay.
So I went with this guitar, and I played these chords in an open tuning, and he really loved the tone and the depth of the sound of the instrument. And all of a sudden, By the Waters was born. Of Sonic Kicks, and we both had the idea to put strings on it, and I've forgotten the name of the guy who did the strings, but he did a beautiful string arrangement. I always argued about the string arrangement, saying it shouldn't be like this and shouldn't like that, and I think, but mainly the guitar tone. I wasn't happy with the guitar tone at the time, and I wanted more, because it was a baritone. I really wanted the baritone to sing, to come out. But listening to it, we just created this beautiful piece. His vocal was amazing. He literally wrote the lyrics there and then, as I was playing the chords. Again, it was like an Ian Brown experience, very organic, him writing the lyrics, me just playing these chords, went in the room, played, after a couple of takes, that was it. And it's just beautiful. I still listen to that tune and go, wow, this guy can really sing. what a great lyricist. And the string arrangements are superb. Very unique string arrangements. Almost in that Nick Drake kind of vein, but not quite different. Just his own style. And that was that tune. And then there was another tune, which was something about the Serene Master or something. It's like an instrumental, very psychedelic, and I took a massive pedal board. So I love guitar pedals, and created this very experimental sounds. I mean, that's really my bag. In the early days, I was working with the guys from the band Japan.
Yeah.
So Mick Kahn, Steve Jansen, Richard Barbieri, I'm very close friends with. I was very much into experimental music, and in that Robert Fripp, King Crimson, David Thorne, Adrian Belew, again, Bowie connections. I was in that phase, and I was getting work in that direction. I even worked with the guys from the Yellow Magic Orchestra from Japan, you know, Yukihiro Takahashi, and all through the JBK connection, Jansen Barbieri Kahn connection. So it was, you know, second nature to play experimental kind of sounds, which fitted with that kind of psychedelic feel that Paul had on those albums, really, very much in that vein, experimenting with looping and Ableton and stuff, and great loops.
And he obviously appeared on some of your stuff as well.
Yeah, on my solo album.
Yeah.
So on Middle Road, he's singing backing vocals.
Is that him doing backing vocals, Middle Road?
And on the outro, he's singing the complete vocal.
Oh, right.
And on the remix of it, which is called the As Was Mix.
Right.
As opposed to the As Is Mix. And he's singing the lead vocal for the chorus. I'm singing the verses.
Right.
And he played Hammond organ on a song I wrote called The Other Side.
Yeah, I know that, yeah.
Yeah, on Lords Alongside. And he also played the mellotron flutes. And live when we played at the Apollo, he asked us to support, and by that time there was a definitive band, which was Mike Joyce, Andy Rourke and myself. So it was like the Roses and Smiths combined. Amazing lineup, and what a fantastic rhythm section, and close friends. And we supported Paul Weller on the either on the Heliocentric or Illuminations tour, I can't remember. And at the Apollo he got up to play Mrs. Kurzweil and his Wurlitzer and his Hammond organ were set up on stage. So when we were playing The Other Side, he just got up and started playing.
Yeah, really?
Yeah, it was a great time. But, I mean, he played the parts anyway, so.
Awesome.
So
it was impromptu, you didn't know he was going to.
It was impromptu, it just came together. And it happened again in 2008. I was away working with a friend of mine, Alan Fairhurst, from Manchester. I went for a bit of a holiday, went out to LA, hang out. With a friend of ours, a mutual friend, and I was on the beach at Santa Monica, as you do. I ran into Steve Craddock, and then he says, all the boys are back at this hotel. So I went over to the hotel, and there's Paul.
Right.
And so the next minute, he's asking me, do I want to do the support at the Wilton Theatre in LA and have I got a band with me? And I was like, no, but I'll put one together. So I literally put a band together that day, and next minute we're supporting Paul again. And then Paul asked me if I wanted to get up and play guitar on one of his songs. So I got up to play, I can't remember which songs they were, but I was busking anyway, you know, just playing, improvising.
Just improvising.
Well, you know, the strangest thing about improvising, I grew up with learning to play by improvisation, by ears. I can't read or write music, but I know straight away that somebody's playing like, I can hear the key. And the immediate port of call is kind of, you know where the notes are going to go. And if it's major, I know where to play. So my note will pick up on the key of the song straight away.
Yeah.
And then I'll choose what I'm going to play. I don't need to know the music. I can predict where the chords are going to go.
He's done that before with other people as well. I think Paul, he's gone to say, right, come on stage and play, and they've been quiet a little bit. Yeah, but like, I mean, it's challenging. But
real
music, you're a real
musician. Yeah. You should be able to do that. You know, just improvise. You don't have to play fantastic, you know, progressions, but you just to be able to hear the music and feel, oh, this is happy, this is sad, and then be able to play your thing.
Someone else who played on your solo record, and obviously you played with back in the day in Stone Roses, was Manny. We've not spoken about Manny as a bass player. What a bass player, what a guy. What was he like to work with?
Yeah, what a dude.
Just a dude, isn't he?
yeah. I mean, Manny, when he played on my solo album, I mean, to play with in the Roses, it was great. Great times. Happy times. He's, you know, a real character, fun guy. Fun guy to be with, as they say. But he's got a style of playing. I love his tone. I love that sound. When he was playing on my album, he played bass on Marassi. I remember that. And it was so strange because Imelda was his wife. It was pulling him off saying, come on, hurry up. I want to get back to the hotel. And on the other hand, I'm not quite sure what he was on or what he was drinking, but it was taking a little bit of time to get it together. And he played on Middle Road as well,
right?
But when we were doing Middle Road, it was difficult for him because he'd had a few, and Weller was in his face giving it, come on, Manny, get it together. and grabbing the bass of him and going, it goes like this. And Manny was like, oh, I can barely keep my eyes open, and all. It was kind of hard for him. So it was just funny. That's all I remember at that time. It was the same when we were recording Marassi on my album. It was funny seeing him under pressure from Imelda and trying to record, because it's quite an epic piece, you know, Marassi, the sections that I drift through, you know, there's that kind of... There's all those chords, and then there's that. And then the section after goes into. And over the top of that, I kind of play. All this kind of Indian Chinese blues guitar, and it's so weird. And that's where that piece came from. That when it drops to the middle eight, which is a huge orchestral Chinese section. But there were a lot of parts to learn on that tune, you know, for him to he needed to concentrate, and he just had a few and got his misses on his case.
Met him a few years ago before the Roses reformed, and he seemed so like psyched about the possibility of Roses ever getting back together. Like he was so passionate about it. For someone, you know, I'm an amateur musician. There's a guy who's been doing it for years. It was so good to see how passionate he was about it. Were you as surprised as everybody when the Roses did get back together? I mean, just for listeners who might not know, one of the quotes from one of the members of the band was, "I've no desire to desecrate the grave of seminal Manchester pop group, the Stone Roses." And then of course they've got back together. They've got new material out. Were you as surprised as everyone else when they got back together?
Yeah, I was surprised. I mean, I could see it from their perspective as artists who, their life's not over because somebody's left. They will continue and they will write, and they would say to themselves that, well, do we have the right to continue as this band? But they are the band. A member leaves, yes, it changes the whole, you know, obviously the lineups change, but it changes the sound, it changes everything about it, especially if he's a composer. Mm. And it's never going to be the same. And for me, I knew that, and I could see that kind of love of the band in fans. And I could see that there was no way, you know, I could have, this could ever be the Roses in that way. Mm. But they wanted a future, so I could see that they were looking to find a new future. So the Roses would change. But I wasn't sure whether, you know, how that was going to go down. But I thought if the songs and the music could speak for the band, then there was a chance. But looking at the lineup, I wasn't sure whether the lineup would work, because I don't know whether we'd all work well together or not, because there seemed to be almost like a pecking order and things like that. So in a sense, I was happy that it ended, because I just thought it diffused the whole situation. Mm. And gave the opportunity for everybody to do their own thing. And there was kind of relief and sadness at the same time. I mean, for some people, they were happy to see, because they didn't want to ruin that memory of, you know, what the Roses were to them. Memories of Spike Island and seeing them at wherever it was, Blackpool or somewhere. Or
when they announced they were getting back together a couple of years ago, how did, did that news go down with you? Were you surprised by that? Yeah, yeah. Were you surprised by that? Could you see that coming, that they were going to get back together?
I was surprised, yeah. I really was surprised. But when I saw the figures, I wasn't so surprised. No, I mean, to be fair, I think from when they sorted their differences out, whether it happened at a funeral or not, I think that's just a natural progression. And they've always been, you know, I think, a band, a unit together. And to see them back together again, you know, and also for people who never saw the Roses to enjoy them live.
Like myself, so I went up to Heaton Park and saw them, and it was fucking amazing. There I never go. Saw them so, first. Like, yeah, it's amazing. Yeah,
no, I got no, there's no judgment on my part in terms of whether they should have got back together or not, because that's just the laws of nature. You know, they're alive, they're still mates, they get together, they play. If they can, you know, they make a great business and a living out of it and get paid huge fees, then so be it. You know, that's what they deserve and that's what they've earned. And if it gives the opportunities for people who've never enjoyed the Roses live, then there you go. You know, as far as I'm concerned, people are happy, they're happy. Those who aren't happy, I'm sorry. Mm. You know, I'm sorry that they're not, but, you know, nothing stays the same. I've got my new project, which is with Mike Joyce from the Smiths, called Asmic at the moment.
Asmic, love it.
Yeah, we're on
social
media.
Tell us about that, so what are you doing?
Well, we've been playing together for about a year or so, just for fun.
Yeah.
There was no agenda. Mike was probably a bit bored at home, not playing his drums with people, so he had various projects he was doing, but we kind of started jamming together, and out of that jamming over a year, we created music, which we thought people should hear, because we really like it, and we thought we'd like other people would like it. So we started thinking about, well, maybe we should share it as a group. So we started to look at it as a project and formulate and taking all these recording sessions and building up a nucleus of material to say that is this set worthy, and then looking at it as well, can we narrow it down to a performance? And it's just been building like that, and just a natural progression of let's just play for fun, enjoying it, and maybe we won't gig, I don't know. I mean, we're just enjoying recording and writing, and the whole process is fun again, and it's just two people. We may bring a third member in, but I don't think it's going to be conventional. but we're seeing how it goes. But we are actually aiming at maybe going out live next year.
Cool.
And it'll be called Asmic, because I used to label the recording sessions as, you know, Aziz and Mike, and then I'd shorten it to Asmic.
Mm.
And then he'd be like, hey, this is Cosmic, not Asmic. And I'm like, he's got that Andy Rock sense of humour. And so I thought, well, or he thought, let's just call it Asmic for now. You know, it's just the two of us, and it sounds like Cosmic. And so the social media sites, like our, you know, Twitter and the Facebook page isn't published, but it is there. Our YouTube channel and SoundCloud page are all Asmic, or cool. Asmic Music, or Asmic Official. It's there to find, and we will be doing odd little releases, maybe for soundtracks and things. We don't know. We're experimenting at the moment, but that for me is one of my main projects. I really love this music that we're doing. I'm really high on it. And at the same time, I'm still working with Davis Singh rather than pursuing that, because I can really express all the Indian stuff through that music, you know, when I'm playing those kind of, you know, I can do all that when I want to. I mean, even working with, like I said, you know, Porcupine Tree's lead singer, you know, Stephen Wilson, which is very experimental, was another way of writing for me. But that kind of ended badly, where I got refused a visa on tour with the US consulate in the middle of a tour, and the rest of the band were allowed to travel, and I wasn't. So I was left behind on the US tour, and then I was really disappointed. I was depressed because the band turned the back on me. I didn't hear from anybody, and Steve turned his back on me and got somebody else in when he promised me that he'd, you know, and they'd wait until January for the visa, and the visa did eventually come through. I remember standing at the counter and the guy's, you know, his computer says no, and me going, is it because I is Welsh? And it was, I mean, it was a joke, but it was, you know, I was serious. And I don't know if it was clinical depression, but my whole life fell apart, you know?
Really?
My relationship, the house. I may end up moving back to Manchester at the time, and it was hard to find my feet. I think the band hit me more, you know, the kind of rejection from the band and their kind of, their hunger to, you know, want to just push on and whatever their own agendas are. And because I believed in camaraderie, that's what the Roses taught me.
Yeah.
You know, a band is a band, and you where's your backup? You know, your backup is your band. And I didn't feel that at the end of that, and I was depressed. And the strangest thing happened. I got a call from a friend of a promoter friend of mine from Birmingham, who asked me to come. Bear in mind, I've been refused a US visa.
Yeah.
And he asked me to come to Stafford to play at the Sports Centre, to play the American National Anthem in the boxing ring for a boxing extravaganza between the NYPD
what?
And the Staffordshire Police. Wow. So you can imagine what was going through my head.
Yeah.
But it was a life-changing moment where I thought, I'm carrying a lot of negativity around with me. I'm not showing the strengths of what a good Muslim is. So I said, I've got to turn this around and be positive and show that this isn't me that's the problem. The problem is legislation and the negativity of other people. So I said yes. So I went in that ring and I played Star Spangled Banner or wherever, you know. And
how'd it go down?
It went down like a house on fire. And the chief of police came to me saying, I know what happened, and I'm really happy you came to do this. And I really, it's changed me, you know, my opinion of Muslims and so on. I was like, it was so the best thing to do, you know, to give out all those positive kind of waves and ripples that go out and affect people and you don't even see it. And
how did that improve your mindset?
Well, exactly. It released the negativity that I was carrying around inside me. It released all that. And I have no animosity, no, you know, negativity about that time and events. And I feel so much better about myself. that every action that I have within me is a positive action. It's like now I do a lot of music therapy. I play at hospices. I played in prisons. I have this kind of Johnny Kashmiri tour that I'm doing. I've got the T-shirt. You can buy the T-shirt. I'm part of a group called the CCG from UCLan, the Preston University, Lancashire University at Preston, which helps community. It's about mental health, well-being. I play with Thameside Arts in Manchester for, helping people with disabilities or learning difficulties and special needs who want to play music and sing songs. I'll play guitar at the, every Thursday when I can be there. And I'll do homeless shelters. I work with Crisis in the past, down to London over Christmas and Boxing Day. I'll just play homeless shelters. There's no Christmas for me. That's my Christmas.
Do you think you're channeling that kind of what could be negative energy in areas you've been in the past to a positive outlet, if you like, and by helping lots of people?
It's almost like balancing your life. I'm putting out. I feel like I've been rewarded in so many ways and I've been privileged. I'm not talking about whether I had money or not. I'm saying that I've been privileged to have worked with all these fantastic guys, to have seen things that no one's ever seen before, that I've been privileged to see, to work with people who are other people's heroes. And I feel just rich. And I feel like if I don't share the knowledge and experiences that I have, then I feel like I'm cheating somebody. Mm. I feel like I'm cheating myself for a start. And that's my reason for doing social work, that I need to balance my life so I can justify enjoying my life. And hence why I do what I do. I work in Pakistan. I'll do seminars, masterclasses, lectures, share my knowledge, Q&As, anything that anybody wants to know. I'm an open book. I'll share that with them. But certainly music therapy, I'm starting to learn, especially after playing children's hospices, that I'm finding the relationship between music and the heart and soul, and about why people live and why this country's the government's making a mistake withdrawing funds from the things that really matter to people, which is arts, music, all the things that people enjoy, whether it's dance or any related theme. These are things that keep the mental health and well-being of the country, of the communities, of the nation up there when they got to deal with so much rubbish. And it keeps you've got to have some enjoyment there, and you've got to have growth. And that's what music, I know that music does for people, why it brings people together, why a Pakistani lad or Muslim can be part of a group with lads who are atheists or they're Christians or they're whatever. It just, you forget all that. And music becomes the, hey, don't you love,
common language, yeah.
This band and that band. Yeah. Remember when Donovan played such and such? Yeah. Or remember when, Bowie did that tune? Or do you remember, whatever you're into, whether it's funk and soul, R&B, reggae, and, Not sharing that with people, enjoying the same things. That's what brings us together. Sharing the music, sharing the love of artists who have left great legacies, or even the undiscovered ones who have, like the guys you've interviewed and who have done so, contributed, not recognised, but they have their own cult following.
You're the social chameleon, yes, you change the sick, the people around you. It's like the waves that hit the shore. You cannot stand the force of law. Oh man, I know it from your nature. Hit the deck as the creator. God, that's his scrolls for you. And you walk into. She's got crosses in.
And education never stops. It's like, I met Donovan through a late friend of mine, Alan Wise, the promoter from Manchester, who died recently.
Right.
His daughter committed suicide, Natasha, God rest her soul. And then Alan was heartbroken and he died a few weeks after. And the funeral's this week, Wednesday. And he introduced me, well, he asked me, if I would play bass for Donovan, because he needed the bass player. And I said, well, initially it was like, bass? And I thought, what fun could that be?
Yeah.
To get to know all those Donovan songs, from Hurdy Gurdy Man to Mellow Yellow to, you know, you name it, and to learn from that. And again, I'm studying the tone and sound of the bass guitar, the flat wound strings, the what bass was being used at the time, what he was doing. I mean, he taught the Beatles.
He taught
them various aspects of writing.
Claw hammer technique.
The New Orleans blues and the jazz and the blues and all these things, you know, he passed on, learned from his friends and hanging out, and the music he's written, the songwriting, the arrangements. For me, it's just a privilege. I mean, it's such a far cry from in the early days. You know, I was learning bass techniques and I was learning. You know, I've learned bass techniques and slap pop, whatever.
Yeah.
I was learning harmonics and things and exploring the guitar, really. I mean, this day and age, a lot of players are into, you know, the tone of the guitar, the beat in the guitar, Newton Faulkner and people like that. Maybe not for me, because I'm like trying to learn chords from Indian ragas, but that would work in songs, and that's what all this paperwork is here.
Yeah.
You can see. You see, this is my own research where I map out the neck and I start to learn ragas and find the chords within there that I can play, which you wouldn't get in Indian music because they don't harmonize in this way, substitute chords as jazz players do. Not that I can play jazz, but I just mean that, you know, I'm starting to see how I can use it within songs. And then, because ragas are beautiful things. I mean, we hear, you know, major scales and kind of hear, I mean, obviously we have, I can't even play that right, yeah? Yeah, we know those do, re, mi notes.
Mm-hmm.
But when you hear it, let's say we're playing an E, and you hear that same thing. But in terms, I would omit certain notes in a raga to make it sound. So in E, see, I've omitted that note.
Yeah.
So it's got its own sound now, hasn't it?
Sounds completely, yeah, just completely
different.
Notes, yeah.
Even though it's just do, re, mi, with a note missing.
Yeah.
I mean, I've got to talk it in like that in layman's terms, because, you know, like I said, I don't know the names of the chords. I don't know, I couldn't write them down for you, but my ears are telling me something, you know. I'm hearing, and I'm saying we're in A, and normally you would, the obvious thing to do would be kind of, for me, I hear, I hear that kind of thing, you know, it's a completely different approach, because I'm a firm believer in a genre of music I've invented called the Asian blues.
The Asian blues, I love it.
Well, yeah, because my playing doesn't come, I mean, in the early days, obviously I'm influenced by Muddy Waters and T-Bone Walker and, you know, Robert Johnson and, you know, to name a few, B.B. King. But my heritage is a different kind of blues. It's the Asian blues.
Mm.
That heritage has its own blues through colonialism, the British Empire, migration, living in a country where you're treated second class in those days. And even now, you know, with visa refusals, just because of the letters in my name. So there's we have our own blues to tell. But then I relate that blues to not the blues scale, the definitive blues scale, but notes within Indian raga, which I play in a blues manner. So whereas I might be going, yeah, okay, that is the blues, but, well, played in a bad way, but I would play a similar way with an Indian scale, with a raga, and kind of look at it in. I play it in a similar manner and with that same heart and soul. Mm. So I thought, well, this is the Asian blues then, isn't it?
Yeah.
So,
I love it.
What you compose with it just depends totally on the person, you know, the knowledge you have of chords and where your influences come from, what your direction of songwriting is, you know. Since I started songwriting in the late 90s, and I started to look at my lyric writing as the main focus.
Mm. And where does that influence come from? Is it
came from home originally, you know, home life, this kind of problem of living a you know Asian, Muslim, Pakistani life at home, and then the confusion between the Western life outside and touring with bands and faced with, you know, the drugs, drink, sex, rock and roll lifestyle, and the confusion of it, and you know, trying to find your place and to be yourself. So the lyrics come from that, my experiences, my life, which is unique to me, maybe similar to other you know, sons of migrants or daughters of migrants, you know. And hence the output, your art has that in it, and my lyrics do. A lot of my lyrics have themes about, you know, my dad telling me off, you know, like Middle Road, for instance, and other themes of being out on a Saturday night in Rush Home in the curry houses and seeing somebody asleep in his curry, you know, somebody telling off the waiters, because I can't stand a word you say, mate, and all that kind of stuff. And well, then lyrics about just experience, you know, that's what I've learned, just being honest. I think if I've learned anything from Ian Brown or Paul Weller, it's the honesty of the lyrics and not being able to not being afraid to express yourself, because the honesty of expression is part of your is the beauty of the song. People can tell when you're lying, they can tell when it's contrived. Anyone with any sense, you know, loves music, knows when something's contrived. There's always a history behind songs, great songs. There's always a pain, there's blood there, if you know what I mean. And that's what I strive towards. Maybe I don't achieve it, but that's the direction. That's what I strive towards. I think I would like to be there where somebody says, you wrote that song and that saved my life. I've had it before with Corpses in the Mouths and My Star. And, you know, some young teenagers have said to me, I listened to that tune and if it wasn't for that song, I'd have killed myself by now.
Really?
And it's the ultimate compliment.
Yeah,
you know?
Well, that must have, like, hit deep when you heard that.
Yeah, it did hit deep. And, I mean, it's a sadness that people are in that position, but there's also a kind of a feeling of pride or satisfaction that you're in the right direction, that what you do touches people, that what you create is shared in a good way, has a positive effect, you know.
If
you save somebody's life, well, I can't think of anything better, you know, in this world.
Cool. Cheers, man. We'll begin to wrap up there. The last question I would say is that what fears do you have for the music industry and how might they be addressed?
It's a difficult question to answer, you know, about fears for the music industry, because I don't actually think about the music industry, because the world's changed. It's a digital world, you know, which means it gives the opportunity for artists to pursue a career in whatever field they're in, music related or arts related. You can reach people, like-minded people, and with a bit of business sense and digital know-how, you can do something. You know, it's not a case of you'll never be heard and you'll never get a gig. You can stream your music if you want to be heard internationally. You don't have to say that, oh well, I've got this small gig and it's only this little poxy little club. Well, if you take your cameras and stream it, then you're reaching the rest of the world. How you reach people, that's another thing altogether. You've got to box clever. So in a sense, I don't have a fear for the music industry. I'm actually glad that industry has died, in a sense. It was inevitable. I mean, it's such an exploitation industry. But within that industry were good people, some very talented people who knew how to set up. Their love for music made them set up record labels. It made them drive around in vans and go sell records for people to hear. That think those people still exist because they just have great ideas, and they train people in the right way. As far as the exploitation, well, that's the side that I'm happy to see. You know, it hasn't gone. It's still there. I mean, you know, Apple needs to sort their ass out. You know, Spotify need to sort themselves out. And all these companies, you know, are still not treating the artists with the respect they deserve.
Space exploration, Olympia stations, NASA corrupted, you have daunted. Space exploration, excursion to stars, on a military mission, on a military journey to Mars. I see you in my stars.
If your aim is, oh, I want to be rich and famous, I can't tell you about that. I don't know that world. All I know is I play the guitar because I love playing the guitar. And if I can still play until I'm like B.B. King's age, then, you know, that is the ultimate for me. But it's just the playing, and I can see that the playing influences. And I mean, some people do say they put the guitar down after they heard me play, but I don't know. You know, it's like, I really think that, you know, you inspire people and you don't even know it, regardless of what level you're on. So that should be reward enough, I feel.
Sage words, man. Great words. Cheers for having us round. We all can't be geniuses, but you're one of them, so keep up the good work, man.
Cheers, man.
Thanks for your wisdom. Thanks for your insight. And, you know, you've given us an insight, and you've helped to, in some way, the next generation musicians, and keep up the good work, man. Really enjoyed that.
Well, I've taken from them, so, you know, I'm giving some back.
More episodes featuring musicians who've worked closely with the likes of Michael Jackson, Oasis, The Beatles, Bob Dylan, Fleetwood Mac, and many, many more, go to thestageleftpodcast.com, follow us on Twitter at thestageleftpod, or like us on Facebook at facebook.com/thestageleftpodcast. See you next time.